गुड डे। वी आर स्टार्टिंग विद द जीएसटी कंप्लीट नॉलेज शेयरिंग एंड इफ यू लिसन टिल द एंड ऑफ ऑल द सीरीज डेफिनेटली यू विल बी हैविंग अ गुड अमाउंट ऑफ द प्रैक्टिकल नॉलेज एंड इफ यू ज्वाइन द एडवांस थिंग इन दैट केस इवन यू कैन गो एंड प्रैक्टिस इन योर ओन कैपेसिटी. So let us start with the introduction to the GST and the introduction to the registration. Now, before the coming of the GST, there were a number of the indirect taxes which was there in our country. And these indirect taxes were maintained by managed by the center as well as by the state. All this act, number of them, has subsumed into the GST. That means all the existing act at that particular moment are no more there in the existence, and it has been merged with the GST. Take an example for the central excise duty. The central excise duty was there on the manufacturing of any goods. Then duties of excise and medicinal and toilet preparation. Additional duty of the excise on the special importance and the textile product also. Then countervailing duty, whenever you import certain thing, there was a countervailing duty known as an additional duty of the custom. Then special additional duty of the custom, whenever the government want to discourage import of particular goods, then the special additional duty on the custom was also there. All this indirect tax, which was managed centrally by the center, has been subsumed into the GST. Similarly, there was a service tax, which was there whenever certain service is being rendered. There were another few laws which were there by the state tax. That means each of the state within the country were levying the tax for their own way and the benefits. Like each of the state has got a state VAT. Like Maharashtra was having Maharashtra value-added tax, Gujarat was having Gujarat value-added tax, Delhi was having his own union territory VAT. Then there was a central cell tax, that whenever there was a transaction between the two states, it was covered under the central cell tax, and the revenue was shared between the center and the state. Then there was a luxury tax, there was an entry tax, there was an entertainment and amusement tax. For entertainment and amusement tax, take for example, when you go for seeing a movie or any theater or any play, there was an entertainment tax which was levied on the ticket price. There was a tax on the advertisement, purchase tax. There was a tax on the lottery. And there was a surcharge and the cess on the supply of the goods and services. All this state set and the central set has now been merged into the GST. And the main law of the GST is known as the Central Goods and Service Tax Act 2017. Which is in effect from 1st of July 2017. The immediate advantage of coming of the GST from the practical angle was that it reduced the litigation which on the input tax. Take for example, previously, when you pay the service tax and you are selling certain goods, then the service tax which was paid was not available as a credit against the tax which you are collecting for the payment of the VAT at that particular moment. Or take for example, if you are a chartered accountant and you are purchasing a laptop. On the laptop, you were paying the state VAT. Now, this state VAT was not allowed as a set-off under the service tax when you were paying as a chartered accountant against the service which you were rendering. So, this input tax, which were not available across the center and the state, but with the coming of the CGST, that input tax to quite a good extent is available. And that is an immediate benefit which has been, or the advantage which has been there due to the introduction of the GST. Now, all the subsequent advantages and the disadvantages, we are dividing into two parts. The advantages that can be also considered as a strength, or it can be also considered as an opportunity. And the disadvantage are weaknesses and the challenges. So in the subsequent slide, we'll be looking to the same GST Act in a different manner. Instead of looking as an advantage and disadvantage, as a from the management concept, we will doing a SWOT of the GST. And this analysis of the GST is available only when you do the registration. For registration, the law is quite in detail and which will be taking up in the next presentation. But here at this stage, let us understand the preliminary aspect. The first advantage is you are avoiding the cascading effect of the taxation. As I told you, that previously if you pay the service tax, it was not available as an input under the VAT. Or you pay the VAT and render the services like a chartered accountant or a doctor, you are not getting the input adjustment. Now that is available. And because of this, you reduce the cost, and when you reduce the cost to certain extent, you also improve your profitability of the company. So let us take an example. That advocate, as on today, as we see further, are not required to get the GST registration. But if they take a GST registration, it will be in their favor, because they will get the benefit of the input tax credit. Now any advocate or any doctor, they incur number of the expenses which can be classified as a direct expenses. For example, advocate do require the computer system. Doctor do require number of material. Take for example, if he is a dentist, he has to purchase a denture which he has to fit into the patient's mouth. So that becomes the direct expense. Or they may be obtaining the service. Take for example, both the doctor and the advocate, they may be obtaining the service of a chartered accountant, and the chartered accountant will charge the GST on their input on the bill. Now that becomes an input tax credit for the recipient of the service, that here in this case it is a doctor or it is an advocate. Then there is an indirect expenses. There are number of overheads like the staff welfare, conveyance, and tea, coffee, and a lot of other overhead expenses which are there. So all this indirect or the stationary expenses, all this indirect expense on which a VAT has been paid, and it is known as an input credit because you are spending the money on the expenses. This amount will be adjusted against your income or the output tax which you collect. So whenever you sell any goods, you collect the tax. Whenever you render any services, you collect the tax. Take for example, you have collected on your output income side a tax of 100 rupees. If you are registered, and on the expense side, on the various expenses, direct, indirect, or the service obtained, you have spent 70 rupees. Then you are required to pay only 30 rupees and such. So it reduces your cost. And that is a strength provided you get a registration done. If you don't do the registration, it doesn't mean the person who is going to render the service to you, he is not going to charge the tax. He is going to charge the tax, but you cannot claim the same as a deduction. So the first advantage you get of the registration is the strength that you reduce your cost. The second advantage, the registration is an online procedure. And because it is an online procedure, it is a quite simple, and anyone can manage registration anywhere in India from one particular place which he prefer. The third important benefits which country as such received, and in the process everyone got the benefit, that previously whenever the goods used to go from one place to another place, at each point there was a check post. And lot of time was wasted at this check post to see that the goods were checking was done, and all other related expenses like petrol. And all these expenses were higher in number. Now this has quite gone down. And to that extent, you can say it is an advantage under the GST registration, or it can also be considered as a strength. Now let us see to the disadvantage or the weaknesses of the GST registration. GST being a procedural law, it required a lot of compliance, and this will obviously increase the operational cost. The small and medium enterprise will find the tax as a higher burden. See, because under the excise duty, the limited registration requirement was 1.5 crore. Under the service tax, it was 10 lakhs. Under the VAT, it was 5 lakhs. And most of the trader, because the excise duty was not applicable to them, they were not covered under the excise duty, which was also another procedural law. There was a tax burden was quite a good, less to that extent. But now, with the registration limit being lesser compared to certain like service tax, it was excise, it was 1.5 crore. But now registration you have to do, even the excise people has to do the registration at 40 lakhs. So small and medium enterprise do find the higher tax burden applicable to them. But if you don't get the registration, your image in the eye of your customer reduces. They understand that you are a small businessman or you are a small entity, you are not having that many number of the client, and obviously from commercial angle, each person try to take the advantage of the same. The another weakness or the disadvantage is you miss out the opportunity to get the finance for your business. See, to carry out the business, a person required the finance. If you are a GST registered person, then obviously bank knows from the transparent record what is the turnover of your company. They can estimate your profitability depending upon your nature of business, and they may give the loan to that extent. But if you are not a registered person, then the loan will not be available because the confidence level or the transparency level is not to the requirement of the bank. It also throws the number of opportunities or the advantages. First one, composition scheme for the small businessman. If you are a small businessman, a composition scheme is available. The meaning of the composition scheme, we are going to deal this in much detail subsequently. But at this moment, just to understand, the composition scheme means the tax rate. If other person is charging at the rate of 18%, you will have to pay from your own pocket 6%. So to that extent, it's an advantage from the competitive business angle because you are paying a tax. But obviously with any advantage or with any opportunity, like I have displayed in the picture of the suite, if you take the suite, your energy level do increase, but over a period of a time, if you go on taking only the suite, it invite number of problems. Similarly, there are disadvantages in the composition scheme also, that you cannot collect the tax which other person can collect. So you have to pay the tax from your own pocket. The person who purchased from you, because you have given the compositions bill, you are not charged this tax separately, he will not get the input tax credit. To that extent, it's a disadvantage. Then higher threshold limit is available for registration. Now, as I told you, under the VAT, the limit was 5 lakhs. Under the service tax, it was 10 lakhs. But now it is 20 lakhs and 40 lakhs, depending upon the area in which you are doing a business. So the limit under the GST is at the higher threshold limit. The next is, it is a compliance oriented law. And because it is a compliance oriented law, to an accountant, the demand of an accountant has now increased. And opportunity in this job sector also has increased. So if you are having a proper amount of a knowledge and in quite in a depth, then definitely you get a better job opportunity. And our lectures of the GST series lecture is one of the step toward that, that if you get the GST knowledge, your job opportunity also improves. Then e-commerce, a special defined e-treatment is there for a particular sector of an organized business. And when it is a law is defined for a particular sector, the law is very clear on numerous aspects. So the management of the same becomes quite simple. So it is an advantage or it is an opportunity. From the government angle, now the unorganized sector is also being regulated, because when you purchase from A, it goes to B. From B to C, all this transaction can be easily traced by the government. And in the process, the unorganized sector, which was previously not able to get a lot of details, now with the incoming of the GST, the government is available getting all this information. So unorganized sector is now being regulated. So that's an advantage from the government. Now let us see what are the challenges which are there, or what are the disadvantages which can, if proper care is taken, these challenges or the disadvantage can be taken care of. The first one, each of the dealer who is a small dealer, he will have to decide whether he should go for a composition scheme or not. Because composition scheme, if your turnover is 10 lakhs, to certain extent it is quite a good. But if your turnover is 30 lakhs, maybe you may be finding some restriction, because your expenses also will be more in that particular case. So then going for a composition scheme does not make a sense. So it is a challenge that each person will have to decide whether he has to go for a composition or not. So he will have to take a professional help of a chartered accountant to find out whether this particular scheme is beneficial for him or not. The second aspect, see, any indirect tax is a tax on your turnover. So if you make any mistake in the wrong classification of your goods or service, because the goods GST is right from 0% to 28% plus cess. So if you wrongly classified your goods as a 12% GST, whereas in your case 18% is applicable, then directly 6% of your turnover, the GST plus interest plus penalty will be collected, which can ruin your profitability. And for that reason, proper classification of the goods and service is very essential. How to do that, we are going to deal in depth in the subsequent lectures. Then it is a procedure law. So compliance to certain extent is costly for a small businessman and the professional. But with the advent of the internet and other technology, a person on its own, if he has got a proper knowledge of the GST, you can file the return. So this lectures and the subsequent lecture, if you constantly go in listening in detail, there is a probability that you may able to file your own return. So do kindly subscribe to my channel to get constantly update on this law aspect. Secondly, online system is completely, GST is managed by the GSTN authority. GSTN authority, government has formed a private limited company whereby the government only is a shareholder. And this complete system is managed online. And the online has got certain limitation. Take for example, as on today, at any given moment, not more than 1,50,000 dealer can be able to file the return. So this is a challenge to the government, that how to see that all the people are able to file the return in time, because at number of the time the website get hang up because of this limitation of 1,50,000. But this limitation may be over a period of a time, with the improvement in the bandwidth and with the improvement in number of other system, may be overcome by the government. The fifth, when you go into the detail, you will come to know that you don't get input for each and every expense. Take for example, if you are your staff and welfare expense include tea and coffee expense, then on tea and coffee that becomes a food, and you don't get input on that particular transaction. So here a proper care is needed to be taken, and certain places government themselves has also now modified the law that on the food services, the GST is at a lesser rate, because in any case, the input tax credit is not available to the user also. So government is taking a due care, but you should be aware of which are the input on which you don't get the credit, and you have to plan out the affair in a proper manner. So here, if you have got any other clarification up to this level, then you can definitely write on the email address given at the top. Secondly, if you are looking for any specific topic in the earlier than the order in which has been decided by me, then you can definitely write a mail on the given address. At the same time, certain statutory warning also has been given. Kindly go through the same. So the opinion given by me over here are under certain assumptions, and this assumption has to be kept in mind, and your particular situation may differ, so that care has to be taken. Now, registrations which are available are of a number of various natures. A transitional register, that means all the existing dealer who were registered under the excise duty or under the service tax or under the VAT, they may come under this transitional registration. The law also specifies that who are not liable for registration. Then there is a voluntary registration also available. And the SWOT analysis has to be done over here. Then certain places registration under specific situation is compulsory. And because it is a compulsory, no question of SWOT analysis arises. But in the first three situations, a person will have to do the SWOT analysis to decide whether he has to get registration or he should not get the registration. And compulsory registration, one has to be more careful in case of a non-resident and the casual dealer. Because in these two scenarios, they required a prior registration. So all this registration part, we will be dealing in the subsequent PowerPoint presentation. And I request you to kindly go through the same. Thank you.